you have adjusted to the dust situation here. Some of us have had, we had a very good cleanup crew, Ali Lowell, Libby Bain, my father and mother, and somebody else. Who else was there, Ali?
You.
Me, I didn't get the trouble, yes. So we did manage to get the front seats clean. We don't guarantee anything back of where you are, Arlene, I guess. So anyway, sit back that far, maybe want to move forward because it may be a little bit dusty, but we thought the most comfortable seat would be probably the one most people would take, so we go from there. The coal block, of course, is one of Bethel's best-known buildings. Probably this building and the Grange Hall, which is down on Spring Street at one time, maybe three or four other buildings probably have more, no other building probably have more history than this building and the one on Spring Street in Bethel's past. We've been very fortunate that this building has been saved, and one of the reasons I think to have a meeting here is maybe heighten a little bit of awareness that this is a magnificent building. I'm glad to see the town has painted the outside. Now if we can get them to restore some of the facade, there's some things missing on the front of the building down the road, and someday maybe we could put this building, this second floor, back in some kind of operation. This is a marvelous space, and it's too bad it's just left to sit here, and hopefully with this editorial, I hope to give you a little bit of history about the area, about the building and how it developed. Most 19th century Maine towns had someone believing that it was important to have a major building in town. And most 19th century towns had some major building. This one came rather late in some cases. Some towns were much ahead of us and have a major building built. But Bethel was one of those towns that had this building built in the 1890s. And one of the things that you'll notice, if you know something about this, we're passing it around here, is the original architectural sketch of the building, which has been found at the Maine Historical Society by George Coombs of Lewiston, one of Maine's great architects. And it was supposed to have been brick building. But the Coal brothers from East Bethel, Elmer and Fred, who conceived of the building, and you'll notice it says on the original plan something about a building in East Bethel. It never was built down there. Maybe they had dreams of eventually building it, but it was eventually built, as you know, on Bethel Hill. And it was built of wood. The plans were almost exactly followed. If you see them circulating, they're over on this side now, if you see them circulating, were almost exactly followed, and the building was very much in George Coombs' design. Almost as soon as the building was finished, and we, for some reason, don't believe this part of the building, the second floor, was finished until somewhat later. But the first floor was finished, and almost as soon as the building was finished, Elmer and Fred lost it because they could not pay the mortgage. And so the Bethel Savings Bank assumed control of the building, and this bank owned the property until it turned it over to the town in 1982. So for much of its history, it has been owned by the Bethel Savings Bank. One of the things I was very fortunate to have done is the Kimball Ames, some years ago, did go through all the Bethel Savings Bank records and pull anything dealing with coal block out of the Savings Bank records. So I have him to thank, among many people, for this, the knowledge we have of this building. We're only going to have about half an hour to talk, so I'm going to have to talk very fast and not to refer to any notes I may have. Hopefully I won't have to refer to my notes too often. But I have a flashlight here in case I have to, so we hope we don't go that far. We might start with the first part of the building, and I think we might want to start down on the side, on this side of the building, down front. interior of the building. Unfortunately, it was put out before it became a national town disaster. Donald Brown had a photography studio next to the citizen office down this side in the early 1950s. And before that, the law offices of A. Herrick and E. C. Park were there, rented on this side, before Don Brown's photography studio was there. On the second floor, overlooking the street, were the offices long used by the selectmen out here on this side, and assessors and overseers before. From the 1890s, there's a clear indication in the town records they moved the selectmen's office from its previous site, and it's really unclear where it was, but it may have been in what was known as Ideal Hall, where the condominiums are on the common. Also, some of the town affairs were conducted previously to that in the Town Hall building, which existed in Middle Ennerville from 1840 to 1870. But when the affairs were moved to the hill, this shows the movement of the town to the hill. After 1870, the town moved to the town selectmen moved to the hill, and it was here that the selectmen were from 1890 on the second floor until 1968, when they moved down to where they are today. In the 1940s, Ike Dyer had a law office on this side, and later it was used as a budget committee room and a meeting room. And some of you who are Republicans remember the Republicans used the caucus there for quite a few years. Henry Hastings had several others had cigars, and that was part of the atmosphere that gave you the flavor of the time. At the top of the stairs, of course, was Odeon Hall. And we don't know how Odeon Hall got its name, but one of the theories is that Joan Kilbourne, who traveled around the world and did go to Greece, apparently somewhere in Greece got the name Odeon. We don't know what it means. I've seen various translations, but we're not sure exactly what it means. But this is the name of how Odeon Hall, one of the theories of how Odeon Hall got its name. Now, I talked with Margaret Herrick Oates, and she totally disregarded that idea, so I'm not sure exactly how Odeon Hall got its name. But we know Odeon Hall was probably, and from the Bethel Savings Bank notes, Kimball Ames, we know that they put the ceiling up in 1907. So we assume that this whole room was finished off about that time. It shows all the signs of about that period of the sheathing. And of course, before that, there must have been just a space. It may have been still used as this today, but it certainly got a lot fancier after 1907 when the Bethel Savings Bank put the metal ceiling up, and this is really a gorgeous metal ceiling and one of the big assets of the building. We also know that Odeon Hall became the center of Bethel social, political, and later religious life. We have this wonderful stage which was used by many groups through the years. And seating was capacity of over 200 in this room. There's still some seats out back here, so we assume that these pews, I think, are a later addition from the Roman Catholic Church days. Gould Academy graduations were held here from 1891 or 2 to 1922 when Bingham Gymnasium was built. We also know that there were countless dances, plays, socials, minstrel shows, concerts, lectures, Chautauqua meetings, Roman Catholic services. They came in the 1950s, early 60s, before they moved to where they are now, down at Lady of Carleton Snow. Later, Harvey Bradford's talkies were here. And if you notice, there's some flyers going around, that's blue paper. come here to seek Dr. Garrett's help at the Garrett Clinic up the street. But Margaret Herrick Oaks and other people who were here at the time believe that she came to visit her friend who was a patient of Dr. Garrett. But we don't know. But anyway, she was here at least twice, according to the newspapers, and did speak in this hall in 1910. And so Bethel people had access to one of the great social workers of her day, and one of the best known today in American history. In 1976, after a little negotiation, we managed to have the Contra Dance here, celebrating America's bicentennial. The building had not been used for many years before that, and this was a major event to have it here. We had to take a special day insurance and for that event, but that went very well. Now, the thing that probably most people remember about this hall, of course, was as a movie hall. And silent movies were here before the talkies. And we know that Doris Laud, one of our most remembered people, for many years played the piano here for the silent movies. We also know that Burl Morgan played the piano here. I'm not sure this is the piano they played. This piano does not play anymore very well. But there may have been a variety of pianos here. We're not sure of that. I don't think that's the original piano that they played for the silent movie. Projectionists included Ray Crockett, Arthur Morgan, Clayton Crockett. We have one of the projectionists over here, Fred McMullen over here. So he was one of the people that used to be a projectionist here in this hall. They tell me also that the most popular spot was up in the balcony. And everyone seemed to like to go up there. It was the furthest away from parents, I guess, and supervision. Margaret told me that her brother, during his high school years, used to announce the films here, and also worked for Harvey Bragg and going around putting up posters around town showing what movies were playing. And almost every movie that was popular that day was played here. If you look at the papers, almost every film that was popular was here. And many of the great stars through the 20s and 30s, and it didn't last much beyond the 40s because we began to rebuild the theater, the modern theater, down below here, and the prices here were much higher than they were down below. Freddie says they were quite high compared to what they were down below with Max Zalin's new theater where the Bethel apartments are, and so this, as a movie theater, declined. Now, one of the great things that were held here for so many years were town meetings, of course. And everyone remembers town meetings, who remembers coming here, remembers what a show it was, what a circus it was at the time. We've lost a lot of the color, I think, today. I remember as a high school student coming here to town meetings and seeing some of the color, but I'm sure I missed some of the best color because earlier, many of the great figures at town meetings had gotten up and spoken at their piece. And you know what they say about town meetings, don't you? They say that it's a chance for everyone to speak, and every damn fool does. And I'm sure that everyone here was a damn fool, but certainly they were outspoken and gave their views. And this was a much more intimate, I think, atmosphere for town meeting than the sort of massive auditorium at Tulsa, which where people get lost in the shuttle. But here, I think you could really see people, and you could certainly hear them. So this was certainly a great spot to remember. One of the things that we're getting losing our lights, so I know I've got to wind up here soon. One of the things that was many people remember about this building was the time a man in the Great Depression came through and had an assistant, I believe. And he climbed the side of the building, became known as the human fly. And many people remember that very well, and what a scene that was, and how everyone held their breath as he tried to get up on top of the roof and just barely made it. He probably did it a little more dramatic to make it look a little more dramatic. He was apparently very good. But think of the desperation of someone who did this for a living in the Great Depression, but it's certainly the way of earning money. The man circulating, gathering people money from the by passing a hat, I guess, and so people had this great show. He traveled all over pressure on our political leaders to maybe think about some uses that might be put to it, because it's certainly a building that could be rehabilitated, with various schemes, and there could be some income produced, for instance, out in the offices out here, there could also be, this could also be used again for town meetings and other public meetings, and something I think we ought to really think about, because it's certainly a building that has a tremendously rich history, and it would be wonderful to see it resurrect once more to its former glory. Thank you very much.
In the citizen office, in the main part of the building, in the soft room, when they put that shed roof on back, they put in hardwood, so that must have been put on at a different time. Did you change everything?
It doesn't show up in various photographs. I would say sometime maybe after 1907, maybe the Bethel Savings Bank records, which I thank Kim Lames for doing, show that they did add something to the building back here, but I'm not sure when it went on, after 1907. So probably it dates in that period, because they seem to be still adding things and renovating the building after 1907. So I would think that from Kimball's notes, that's what we might want to look for. The photographs in 1895 don't show that on there, so I assume that it was some years after that that you saw it.
Beyond that, is that little 10 by 10.
Known as the hen, was that known as the hen house?
That's known as
the hen house.
You saw it as the hen house.
Hen house. Right.
But that's where the gasoline engine was to run the machinery inside the borrow electricity.
That's right. And I guess one of Greg Crouser's job was to turn on the power for the presses downstairs, for the linotype. That's what John told me. One of his jobs was to build a fire in the selectman's office and turn on the linotype for the citizens to run their presses.
Oh, turn the metal pot on.
Okay, that's what it was, okay. Any other questions or comments? Yes, Raleigh?
There used to be a curtain here, I mean, I was talking about this, and it came up and down and separated. There was a seam on it. There was a little slit right in the center. And this is where the people in the current cast or whatever looked out to see how many people were there when it was time to go. And as the years went by, the slit got longer and longer.
I looked out back the other day for it, but I don't think there's much of it left.
There's some of them left out back there. Yeah, there's a little bit I think left out there, but that's very interesting. Any other memories or comments or questions?
Emma Young was another
pianist. Okay. I think I have her on my list, but I didn't get her on this list, so. Yes. There was a stage built?
Yeah.
I assume it must have been built in that 1907 period, because Kimball talks about they put the ceiling up and they did some renovation here, but I'm not sure whether that tells us what exactly the stage was, but we don't seem to know that. I haven't seen any newspaper articles or columns where it shows that that's happened, but and it gives an exact date, but I assume 1907 is probably a key date when this building was assumed its present look. Yes,
what was the last night of all the views except for the
I think probably late when they built Telstar, that was sort of the end of it. I think they began to move down there. Of course, for years the room 68. The rumor was that this building was unsafe, and of course in 1969, Ed Vachon tells me that when they had the tremendous winter, they got worried about the roof up there. Because that was when the savings bank was down below us here, and so they had a structural engineer come up, and he said you could drive a freight train across it. And it's probably still that way today. So it's a very well constructed building and should stand for many years if it's taken care of. Any other comments or questions?
We had some kind of meeting up there, I can't remember how many years ago, but I haven't been down to 13 of them. I think it was a planning board meeting or something like we had up there.
Up here?
Yeah, I'd like to get the first one.
Yes. I don't think it's been used number of things that have to look at. It would cost somebody, of course, the bathrooms have to go back, heating system. There are a number of things you have to look at, and whether it's economically feasible to keep a building like this. But it's something maybe that I should really looked at, because no one's really studied the proposition, I don't think. Yes, Tom?
Did they take out both heating systems when they...
I think they just disconnected it. I'm not sure, but I seem to think they disconnected it when they did the renovation.
Did they lift the hot air duct?
I think the ducts are here, but I'm not sure what's down below.
This part of back here.
They took out the chimneys you see up front, too, because the chimneys are gone, so... but they weren't being used anyway, so... Yes, Margaret?
Exactly, when they had the voting here, for many years, this is where we came up with...
Right.
Increasingly, all the people complained about the stairs. That you could get an absolute balance, actually.
That's right.
But I think that's one of the major problems, is that the stairs are very steep for the election of the town meeting for that. It never bothered me for moving.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Of course, now you can have one of those riding things up and down the stairs, so that would not be a problem today.
The other thing.